Long before the World Science Festival, though, authors and writers have been bringing science to a lay public that is increasingly sophisticated. And what we want to do is explore the literature of science. Tracy mentioned science and story. In many ways, the story of science is the story of civilization, the story of technology, the story of politics, industrialization, the story of the transformation of our world. And we have three authors who typify, in some sense, the very epitome of science writing in our time. And I'm going to introduce the three of them to you and offer a little example of their work, because I think we have three writers who are very, very different in their approach to science and science writing. How many of you are consumers of science literature, science writing? Great. And how many of you know our three presenters? Right, there we go. And how many of you have your books ready to be signed? There we go, that's right. They'll be very happy to hear about that. All authors, even if they are scientists, they are authors in the end, and they love to sign books. Here is our first presenter, and I'm not going to introduce her background, but I am going to just read from her latest book, My Beautiful Genome. Quote, this is towards the beginning of the book, seems to be a very personal story. Let's start with alcohol. Have any of your first degree relatives had any problem with alcohol? Problem? My father. Some would say he had a certain problem with alcohol. Starting your day with vodka in your coffee and working your way through with malt liquor might be called by some people a bit of a problem. And thus begins a very long and wonderful narrative about genomics and life sciences and life all fused together. Lone Frank holds a PhD in neurobiology, has built an international career as a science journalist and author, well-known voice in debates about science, technology, and society. Her most recent book, as I mentioned, and that's a quote, My Beautiful Genome. Our next panelist is someone who I met in a book called Chaos. Are you familiar with this book, Chaos, by James Glick, who is a science writer for the New York Times, who wrote a book called Chaos that was about a subject nobody knew about and changed completely our world. And in many ways, he was on to something, that the subject was changing the world already. He just reported it to all of us. And of course, chaos and chaos theory and fractals and all the kinds of things that James Glick discussed in that book have become part of popular culture. And I don't think you could do a Star Trek movie without some reference to chaos theory or the Mandelbrot set, etc. But here is a selection from one of James Glick's more recent works. This is the book Isaac Newton. He, of course, wrote the fabulous biography of Richard Feynman. You familiar with that as well? Know that the story of scientists, the story of people in the sciences, is also a story of science itself. But here's a typical example of James Glick's style, talking about Isaac Newton. His life's path across the Earth's surface covered barely 150 miles from a hamlet of rural Lincolnshire southward to the university town of Cambridge and thence to London. He was born in the bedchamber of a stone farmhouse on Christmas 1642, as the calendar was reckoned in England, but the calendar was drifting out of step with the sun. His father, Isaac Newton, yeoman, had married at 35, fallen ill, and died before his son's birth. English had a word for that. The child was posthumous, thought unlikely to resemble the father. Please welcome writer James Glick. And of course, call him our fearless leader, Brian Green, who is co-founder of the World Science Festival. How many of you are familiar with Brian's work? Brian really is one of the voices of modern physics today, both for a lay audience and for people who study at Columbia University. I wonder if he quizzes them on his own work. Let's talk about Brian's sort of approach to writing, which is very different from that of Lona and James. And in many ways, you're taken into a conversation with scientists empowered to think the way that they do. And you can imagine a conversation with Isaac Newton in some of Brian Greene's work. Here is an example from The Hidden Reality, which I highly recommend. Newton's making a mistake. Only Brian Greene can write something like that. But you can't blame him. The burden lies with the cursory summary you gave him of general relativity. Don't get me wrong, it's understandable that given only 5 minutes, one of which was spent explaining baseball, a lot of physics can be explained by baseball in Brian Greene's work, you focused on curved space-time as the source of gravity. Newton himself had called attention to the fact that there was no known mechanism for transmitting gravity, and he always viewed that as a yawning hole in his own theory. Naturally, you wanted to show him Einstein's resolution. But Einstein's theory of gravity did much more than merely fill a gap in Newtonian physics. Gravity in general relativity differs in its essence from gravity in Newton's physics, and in the present context, there is one feature that cries out for emphasis. Kind of physics meets cliffhanger there. Please welcome Brian Greene. So to the three of you, let's just start. Is this a golden age of science writing in the sense that there are so many titles, so many authors out there, and there seems to be an enthusiasm for science writing, whether it's books, magazine articles, that sort of a thing? Lona?
Well, there's a lot of stuff out there, you're right. But I also think that there is a lot of not so good stuff. So I wouldn't say that it's a golden age.
So there's a signal to noise issue in the sense that there's a lot of bad stuff out there.
I think there's actually a lot that is done sort of by a formula. That, this is how science writing is done, and we'll now do a volume on this or that or the other, and it's kind of the same thing over and over again.
What would you say is the crap to legit ratio?
I think, you don't want to say that everybody else's stuff besides your own is crap, but the signal to noise is definitely a problem. Lona's right. On the other hand, without saying it's a golden age, you certainly have to look at how things have changed over the last 20 years. There's so much more writing about science, I think. It's taken for granted by people that that they ought to be able to find out about scientific discoveries and scientific controversies in the newspaper and on TV. People expect to see really cool documentaries on TV I believe that people have become aware in a way that they weren't 20 years ago of how embedded science is in everything they do from morning till night.
Brian, would you say that scientists have become more passionate evangelizers of their own content, making sure people know it in its legitimate form as opposed to letting it be filtered through some of the bad filters that Lona referred to a moment ago?
I think there's been a huge sea change. I mean, we've all heard the stories, some firsthand, of Carl Sagan being somewhat ostracized by the scientific community for being one of the early people who went out there and tried to make science available to a broad audience. So I know we're focusing here on writing, but just to give you one example, when we started to think about the World Science Festival and wanted to build a board of advisors, the natural thing was to go to Nobel laureates to give it some sort of, public gravitas associated with those kinds of scientists. And a number of people that we spoke to said, yeah, you could try that, but, science for the public, they got other things they want to do, probably aren't going to get many who will sign on. We had 100% of the Nobel laureates we approached, 25, signed on to do this because there had been a mind change that this was now an important thing to do, to get real science out to the public. And I think you do see that in the number of books that are written. Yes, there's an interesting curve of quality, but that's true in anything, right?
Sure.
Pizza, right? New York pizza. There's good pizza, there's bad pizza, and there's mostly mediocre pizza. And that will be true for any commodity that you're talking about. But scientists are really trying to get their stuff out there. And when the Higgs boson was found, and then I'll be quiet, the thing that was exciting to me...
He always says that.
And it's never true. Right. When the Higgs boson was discovered, it was remarkable. You could go to the New York Times and find great articles about it, or you could go online and have scientists like, Matt Strassler and Sean Carroll, who are, regular bloggers, give you the detailed insight into the data and whether you could believe it. So you could go the whole range, from technical to non-technical, just by sitting at your desk. That, to me, is a golden age, that you can do that.
How much of that, and I'll ask Glick this, since he's the journalist here, How much of that is driven by a real sense that scientists want there to be a societal understanding of science, a level of fluency that will help their work? And how much of it is that all scientists want to be the Justin Bieber of physics, just like Green is over there?
So, what? Don't tell me he was offended by that.
No. Just look at his face. He looks really offended.
When I did my stint as a daily newspaper science reporter for a couple of years, which was not that long ago, but it was a few years ago. I remember that you could call scientists up to ask them about something, either a piece of work they had done that had just appeared in a journal or that had not yet appeared in a journal, and they would be reluctant to come to the phone because they were afraid of how it would look to their colleagues. Their colleagues would say, oh no, you're seeking publicity, and they would say, look, you have to just wait for the journal article, report what that says. I have nothing to add to what's been peer-reviewed. That, I think that has completely changed. And it's partly changed for the noble reasons you're mentioning, John, that scientists sincerely understand how important it is for their work to be understood, and it's partly changed for the most crass of reasons, which is they're competing for funds, and in some fields at least, they feel that getting their name in the paper will make it easier for them to get the next grant.
Go ahead, Lana.
Yeah, I mean, I actually think that there is something a little bit dangerous about exactly what you're getting into there, that a lot of scientists are seeing, the media as a place you have to be, and you you have to get your stuff out there, and you have to maybe portray it a little bit more sensational than it really is. And then you have journalists who also want to, write sensational stories. And you see it, I think more and more that there's a sort of academic journalistic complex forming that, there are all these interests in getting these really big stories out there. Maybe they're not always that big.
How does that manifest itself in genome science? In the sense that popular media depictions of what mapping the human genome was supposed to bring to us all, codes for life itself, diseases that could be specified with barcode, that sort of thing. It certainly hasn't turned out that way. No. If you look at your work as a mission to try to correct something that has caused prevailing misunderstanding of genomics, what would that be?
I mean, I think it's interesting to look at how oversold genomics has been, really, from the beginning. I mean, just remember the two presidents getting up there, or the prime minister and the president getting up there and talking about the language of life and all this stuff. And I remember being at the first conference of HUGO, the Human Genome Organization, after the sequence actually came out, and everybody was kind of despondent. Like, they had all these great big machines back in the lab, and they were going to, they still needed funds to keep the whole thing running. And what are we going to do? What are we going to throw ourselves at now? And nobody had any really good ideas, but then you set up more genomic projects and more of them, and let's look at some diversity here and some other things here. And I think there hasn't been enough writing about that at all. It has all or mostly been framed in that sort of, oh, it's so sensational, and it will get us to this greater place sometime.
Let's talk a little bit later about the broader politics, because I think this is really, really fascinating. But in one sense, the reason the three of you are here is because the craft of what you do is really important to the audiences that you've managed to find for each other. In your particular case, Lona, you use your own personal story as a way of helping people to understand not only the significance of genome science, but also the pitfalls. You, as a traditional journalist, I think do all kinds of great reporting, and some of the details of that passage I read about Isaac Newton just conveys so much of the rich detail of what makes Isaac Newton unique. In your work, Brian, if I may speak just as a reader of it, there's a mission for me. You're constantly cheering from the side saying, you're going to get this. You're definitely going to get this. Just stick with me here. So it's almost the personal narrative of understanding physics at a very, very high level. How do you approach your craft if you do that? Lona?
How I approach my craft? I mean, I think of... I think I I have the ambition, at least, that I would like to do not popular science. I hate that expression. I would like to do, you know, science literature. I mean, I would like to write as well as Philip Roth. Maybe not in this life, but in another. And so I try to make it, you know, an actual story that's a good read. And, you know, of course, has a lot of subject matter. And I think you can really put an awful lot of complicated subject matter into a narrative that's interesting. And I think there's an awful lot out there, as I said in the beginning, that's formulaic. And where you get some subject matter, but not really a lot, and you get it repeated and repeated and repeated because it's about a take-home message. And I don't think that science books should, you know, have take-home messages necessarily. So I would just simply approach this as literature that has a topic.
I was sitting next to a scientist this morning at brunch who said, "Oh, you're a science writer. That's so great." What you do is so important. I'm so glad that. How do you make what we do seem exciting? And I thought, and I hope I didn't offend her. I said, I don't want to make what you do seem exciting. That's not. I don't care if it seems exciting. And also, I didn't say, but I've never felt that the scientists were my constituents or my clients. My readers are my constituents. And having said that, each time I write about something in science or anywhere, it's because I'm interested in it and because I think there's something there that matters to my understanding of the world or to people's understanding of the world. So if I write about Richard Feynman, I mean, you don't have to sell Isaac Newton's importance to anybody, but when I wrote about Richard Feynman, his work was, you know, to people like Brian, he was known to be the real deal, but a lot of people had never heard of Feynman.
Was it the moment after the Challenger disaster when he was right there on stage as part of the looking into that disaster and did that fabulous experiment of how the O-rings actually froze up if you toss them into the ice water? Is that the moment you said to yourself, I want to know more about this guy, or did you know a lot about him before that?
I had heard his name from time to time writing about science. You know, you rub shoulders with physicists and his name comes up. His name would come up in a certain way. People would say, you know, and I had to give a talk and Feynman was in the audience. and my ears would perk up. But the episode you're describing, I think, is probably the first time a lot of people got a picture of Feynman.
Do you know what I'm talking about? The Challenger? What happened? Okay, great.
And those hearings were televised. And in fact, I think somebody's just done a dramatization or a documentary. And anyway, this was during my daily newspaper reporter phase at the New York Times, and I heard that he was really sick, I guess in the fall of 87. And the way things work at the Times, I knew that that there would not be an obituary on file for him the way there would be for an important politician or important movie star who was going to die soon, and so I volunteered to write one, and I started researching it. So that's how I learned about Feynman. But so the challenge in writing a book was to not to sell his importance, but since I'm not a scientist myself, and my readers aren't, presumably, to try to gain an understanding and express an understanding of why somebody matters to all of us, whose work is essentially very technical.
How do you approach what it is you do? When did you decide to take a leap from the professorial function to really popular nonfiction?
Well, I really began when I was asked to give a lecture at the Aspen Center for Physics back in 1996. They had a public lecture series, and that was the first public lecture that I ever gave, and it was on string theory. And people came up afterwards and said, wow, that was exciting, you know, what can I read? And there wasn't really anything to read, and that sort of began to get the wheels turning for me. But I guess, I don't know if this is an advantage or not, but since I'm not a writer by trade, I have a day job. You know, I have a steady income that comes from being a physicist. That's what I do. I only write when I'm excited to write about something. I don't have to write. So since I'm already writing about something that I'm really excited about, the engine is already there. And I see my role as the translator, to go from this exciting stuff that's written in this funny language of squiggles on pieces of paper published in obscure journals, and pick out from that the elements that can naturally be put into plain English, described with metaphors or stories or anecdotes or cheering on, whatever you want to call it, and in that way make an exciting read of material that only previously a small but very select group of people are very excited about.
So you are trying to make what physicists do more exciting.
I wouldn't say more, equal.
All right.
I want to be completely true to where it's at. And that's a critical point because I agree with Lona completely. I can't stand hype. I hate science hype because there's so much great science, you don't need to hype it. So when I see various articles in popular magazines where they week after week are trying to talk about these new breakthroughs, I guess to sell the magazine, it's distressing, it's disturbing. And what I did, for instance, in the book you have there, the example you gave, The Hidden Reality, that's a book about a very esoteric, far-out subject, other universes. But the book is very balanced. It's giving arguments why you might take it seriously. It's giving other arguments why you shouldn't take it seriously and trying to come to some consensus of where that's at. And there'll be a program tonight where you'll see those two sides battling it out on stage. But in no way is that book a cheerleading book for the multiverse. It's simply laying out exciting reasons why it might be true and other reasons why we should be skeptical.
Lona.
I was just thinking that actually, for me, it's not so much the science itself that's the really interesting thing, but it's the way that the knowledge that comes out of science affects the way that we think and really affects and shapes our culture. And I think that's often not really regarded. I mean, there's so much science communication these days, not so much science journalism. It's not critical. It's science communication, and it's all about, oh, this is so exciting, you know, a new cure for cancer, maybe. But there's too little about how is it going to change the way that we, you know, think that we function as people and the way that we interact with each other and our culture.
Again, you've raised a great issue that really speaks to the question of what it is that we're trying to get out of science literature or a study of science. Is it understanding? Is it a sense of self-awareness about our place in the universe? Is it all of the above? And we'll talk about that in a minute. Let's stay on craft for just one more second here. You all use metaphors in different ways, yes? Yeah, you particularly. Give me an example, all three of you, of a metaphor that you fell in love with to try to explain what's going on, and a metaphor that you tried to make work but just didn't quite work out. And I'll let you think, Lona, for a moment, but Green, I know you have maybe 20 of those.
I have one example. In my first book, The Elegant Universe, there's a chapter on quantum mechanics. It's chapter 4, I think, if I remember correctly. But it was the last chapter I wrote because it was the most intimidating of the subjects in the book for me to try to explain. And I knew I needed it because I was referring back to it in all those later chapters, you know, what I explained earlier in quantum mechanics that had to be done.
And you hadn't written the chapter?
I had not written the chapter yet. I was putting all the burden of everything on that chapter, you know.
So,
I was trying to figure out how to describe this notion of the world's energy coming in discrete packets, which is sort of one of the key ideas of quantum mechanics. So I was thinking, and then basically I just came upon an idea, probably it's been done many times before, I don't know, but, you know, money, coinage, right? That also comes in discrete chunks. You got pennies, nickels, dimes, quarters. And I found a metaphor that leveraged that by telling a little story about kids that were stuck in a warehouse and they couldn't get out or turn the heat up unless they had the right coinage to get the right amount of money for the miserly landlord. And you put this all together into a story which I can't recount on the fly, I don't remember how I did it, but it was a story that made sense. And you just read it, and by the end of it, you're like, yeah, I get it. The discrete notion of this quantum aspect of the world was sort of there. So that, to me, is sort of one of the favorite ones that has worked. The ones that haven't worked are, you know, enormous. You know, and you just throw them away, and you start again.
Editor tell you that, or do you decide?
If an editor doesn't get something, then I realize I've got to work harder. But actually, the best editor for me is that person right over there. Because with all my stuff, I have her read it, and I then quiz her. And if she can say it back to me, I know that it's worked. And when she can't say it back to me, I'm like, what's wrong with you? It was so clear, you know? And then she'll tell me why it wasn't clear, and I'll get angry, you know? And then I'll go back upstairs, and I will rewrite it and try it again. And finally, I'll get it. So that, and then when it gets to the editor, it's like, okay, it's good, it's fine.
Kind of a household sitcom.
Yeah, right.
The green household, the bigger bang, I suppose, yeah. Right. So how does metaphor work in your...
I wish I had something as good as that, but I don't feel I work that way. I mean, it's definitely true that I think metaphor and analogy are essential, and I don't disdain them. I mean, I don't think that it's in any way cheating to describe something metaphorically. The best single example, maybe it's not that great, of an insightful burst of metaphor that I heard in the science reporting business isn't one of mine. And it's, the reporter was Walter Sullivan. Did you ever know him? He was, I overlapped with him a little at the New York Times. He was the dean of the science staff of the New York Times when I got there. And he had done a story about the discovery at Bell Labs by the radio astronomers of the microwave background of the universe, and was trying to convey its importance.
This was the background noise that suggested that it's left over from the Big Bang.
Right. Right. And the phrase that either he came up with or the physicist came up with, and I'm sorry, I don't know which of them to credit for, was one of them said, look, this is the echo of the Big Bang. And that was nice. I mean, I think that tells the story. I think it's probably, correct me if I'm wrong, Brian, but I think it's probably so good that it might not even be a metaphor. It might be pretty close to the reality of the thing. But it's a way of understanding. Was he nodding or shaking his head?
Well, it's a beautiful image, and I think many of us have appropriated it since, because it does have this poetic quality to it. But there's some truth to it,
right,
but
right.
But it's so tied to sound. And
it's not bouncing off anything.
That's right. So I guess the one thing I would say, I don't mean to interrupt you at all, but it reminds me of one small point, which is when I use a metaphor, all metaphors are broken in some way. They fail in some way. And one thing that I do is I let the reader know after the metaphor, here, this is what about that metaphor you can really trust. Here's the part, you know, use it to help build a mental image, but that isn't really right. And I think as long as you do that, you can really hit that sweet spot.
Right. But I also have a view that that's true of the scientific theories. That the scientific theories that you're trying to describe and convey to the reader are themselves only models. They are not perfect. There's some dispute about this in science, you know, whether you can come up with an ultimate theory of anything, much less everything. But my view is that every scientific theory is in itself a metaphor.
That's very Niels Bohr.
Is it?
Yeah, pretty much.
Has the metaphor of genomics got us in trouble?
It's a metaphor in the sense that Brian just mentioned. It leaves things out.
On the other hand, it's a metaphor that can predict the magnetic dipole moment of the electron to 10 decimal places. Holy smokes, 10 decimal places.
Okay.
That's more than just, you know, airy-fairy description.
I didn't say it was airy-fairy.
No, I know.
So if you can't do it to 10 decimal places, folks, give up. But the predictive quality of models, I think, is one way of evaluating the success of a model or a theory or a metaphor. But in terms of literature, the extent to which it imparts real understanding as opposed to some sort of imperfect myth that creates more problems than it solves, I think is another way, and probably the way that a writer will evaluate a metaphor. How does that work in your...
I mean, I don't think I come up with very many metaphors myself, in fact, but I kind of fell in love with one that I had I used in my book on neuroscience, and it was, I think it's the anthropologist Pascal Boyer who came up with it. He called religion or superstitious ideas a cognitive parasite. I think that is just such a great image. I mean, these ideas fit so well with our cognition and the way our brain works that they just sort of latch on and sit there. And so I used that and quoted him, of course. But then I sort of elaborated a bit on it, like, are we ever going to get rid of religion? No, probably not, because it's a very efficient parasite. It's you know, just like bacterial infections or whatever. You can fight them, and you can maybe, you know, get them, you know, back for a while, and they will resurge. But they will also, like, if you look at religion, how it, you know, develops, it is, again, it's a great metaphor for that. It's a parasite that mutates all the time with how, you know, the world develops.
So the fact that we are speaking at a Jesuit university, we would call this the antibiotic.
Yeah.
And the university itself is the parasite. Let's pursue that, though. This idea of cognitive parasites suggests that there is a perilous element to science literature in the sense that you can stumble upon something that sounds great and will take over the mind of the reader, and you essentially, diverted from your mission. If you're trying to get them to understand what's really going on, you failed, but they feel as though they understand what's going on. Is that a pitfall of scientific writing?
I think it is. And I think you see an awful lot of science writing where it is, you go from metaphor to metaphor because, oh, it sounds so great, and especially in articles. And it is seductive. And I think a lot of people, when, you know, when I talk to readers, for example, there are things that you know, about, say, evolution, for example, that they haven't really gotten the idea. But there is some kind of, you know, vulgar Darwinism out there because there are so many metaphors surrounding, you know, natural selection. And people have sort of ingested them, but they don't really work.
Stephen Jay Gould, in the end, I think, wrote very angrily about how people hadn't gotten evolution despite his best efforts and despite the fact that it was an accepted theory. Do you think that in some ways you can fail at this, Brian?
Well, it's an interesting thing. When I wrote my second book, Fabric of the Cosmos, there was a section in there that has to do with some pretty difficult quantum mechanical ideas that goes by the name of Bell's theorem, entanglement. Einstein called it spooky action. And I was at pains in that chapter to find metaphors that would really give this argument that something over here could affect something over there. And I really went through it in what I thought was a really good way, that step by step by step, you have to follow all the chains, but you can get the idea. People who had never encountered that subject before really liked it. People who thought they already knew it, read it and felt like, God, why are you making it so complicated? Because they had ingested an earlier metaphorical description from some other source, thought they really understood it, didn't really, and then my version felt overwrought to them. So it's an interesting thing that can happen where you can mislead the reader into thinking they have an understanding of something that they don't. And then if someone else comes along and really tries to explain it, because it matters to really get it, not just the vague idea, it can feel like that description is somehow off the rails.
Do editors in science writing want a happy ending in that you come to an understanding at the end? Do they divert you from characterizing something that is fundamentally difficult to understand, that reaches maybe a dead end or a vast kind of frontier where we don't know what the next step is necessarily? Is that harder to write about than the light bulb coming off, you know, going off on the head kind of thing?
Yeah, I think there is a sort of the feeling out there among a lot of editors that you would like a nice package, you know, with a beginning and a middle and an end, and it would be best if you could have, you know, if you could sort of explain the whole book in the first page. I mean, I was actually told that, I mean, your books will never sell in the US because you don't explain on the first page what it's about. So, I mean, there are schools of you know, science writing, and that's one of them, and I think it's too bad. I mean, I like when I read something to, you know, get the sense that there are questions at the end of this. There are questions coming out of this. It's not that I get a you know, nice little package, oh, this is the solution to the problem, and I can throw it away.
In terms of life science, and let's go back to what you were saying before, how does your work help a reader think about who they are, how this science, this developing science, is actually changing one's, you know, understanding of life itself. How do you want them to think about themselves differently from reading your work?
Well, one of my missions is to get people to actually think of themselves as, you know, intricate physiological or biological systems instead of, you know, people with souls. The soul is dead, for Christ's sake. And and I mean, for some people that works really well. And
for others, I bet it doesn't work quite so well.
Yeah. But it's, I have missions, of course, in my work as well. And I also have, one metaphor I really like that I've encountered a lot of readers that don't like. I think that we should look at life not as, you know, life is not a substance or a sort of a life force. It's really, it's information. I mean, basically, it is the genetic information, and it's sort of, you can look at it as, you know, a river of information that flows through time and space. And all of us, each of us, you know, are just temporary vessels for this, you know, life information.
You spend a lot of time in your book, The Information, trying to specify or describe or perhaps lead us into some insights about notions of consciousness that come out of the complexity of this information space that Lona talks about. Seems to me you're less likely in your books to say the soul is dead and more likely to say something like, it's rummaging around in here somewhere and here's where you might find it. How does the information convey some of these complex ideas of soul and personality?
Oh man, I was all set to deal with the understanding question and now I have to explain consciousness.
You do what you want.
Well, did you really say the soul was dead? What did you mean? You mean it's...
I think the idea of an incorporeal soul, something that's not...
Oh, that's dead.
That's not in our brains.
Something extra. I am endlessly fascinated by the question of consciousness, and it is one of these questions. It's one of these things where I actually feel that I have some understanding of how it works. I really believe... You can approach me afterward that I know the secret of where consciousness comes from, but...
Can you explain it in one page?
Not only can I explain it in one page, but I don't think I could... I don't think I could write a book that would explain it. I've read some books that explain consciousness, and in the course of reading certain of these books, I have felt temporarily bursts of understanding. I mean, everybody here must have this experience, and it's an experience that we both want and don't want our readers to have in reading our writing. The experience of thinking, aha, I do understand this, and then a half hour later thinking, wait a minute, no, I don't. I mean, that was all smoke.
I think that's only you.
I feel, you know, you asked about consciousness. That is the one question that I find most difficult in all of science to do. I mean, not that there aren't lots of other things in science that I don't understand, but I think it's fair to say that that's one that no one in science has a handle on.
Where does the information metaphor, the ideas of information space, life is information, consciousness is information, physics is information, how does that intrude and change the metaphors and the understanding of physics in your world, Brian?
Well, it's huge, and it's becoming an ever more prevalent force in the way that we are thinking about things. In fact, one of the deep puzzles that has driven physics for decades and is now really coming to a head is a concrete question about information. If you throw things into a black hole, where does the information that they carry, where does that information go? So if you throw your iPad, your cell phone into the black hole, there's information there. Does it disappear from the universe, which is what Stephen Hawking said, or is it somehow still there and it can be recovered in some way? And it's a deep question because if information is really lost, that violates a central precept of quantum mechanics, which says that information can't be lost. So that theory would have to be radically changed.
Although if you go to TechServe and give them your hard drive, they'll tell you, no, it's lost.
They don't know quantum physics.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's the issue. So a question right now is just this one. We think we know the answer to it, But in the last year, actually, a paper was written which says that if the answer we thought was true, namely that the information does come out, if that's true, then our understanding of black holes has to radically change. So this is one of those moments in physics, those wonderful moments when there is tension between two ideas that both seem to be right, but seem not to allow the other to be correct. And those are the moments where breakthroughs happen.
And the thing that I find exhilarating about this, and it's really more than anything else the motivation for my last book about information, is that a physicist like Brian is talking about information as such a fundamental building block of the universe, that it's a thing, it goes into the black hole, and then what happens to it? That's not a question that physicists would have asked generations hence. They would have said, well, energy can go into the black hole, or matter can go into the black hole. These are the fundamental building blocks of the universe. What I've tried to understand, and I don't understand it fully, is what does it mean when physicists say now that as John Wheeler used to say, that the fundamental particle might not be the kind of subatomic particles that are discovered in high energy accelerators now, but might actually be the bit.
I was just thinking that
I was going to answer you, but
I was just thinking about information, how that is becoming a thing in the life sciences. The life sciences used to be something where you could sit there with a few petri dishes and make a new discovery, but now it's all about big data and information. And you know, the more full genomes we get, the more we will know about the genome. But it seems that the information is just collected and gathered. It's like, you know, immigration here in this country, all these fingerprintings and nothing comes out of it. And the same thing with the life sciences. Knowledge is not really advancing. And
how
it's
would
just
you say,
information
how,
gathering.
Well, let's talk about that for a moment. Then all of you write to a certain extent about the process of discovery, you know, what represents an actual breakthrough. A lot of you have described great stories of great experiments and insights that people had as scientists in the course of your writing. What is a great story of scientific discovery in your view, and where do you think the next one is going to be in the domain that you spend a lot of time on? Lona?
I mean, I would really like to see something. I imagine that there must be something about the genome and how it works that hasn't really been thought out, and that people, it seems, are looking kind of in the wrong places. Just, you know, get us some more sequence data and we'll put it through the computers and we'll get some nice algorithms. And it doesn't really solve the problem of, for example, the missing heritability. We know that tons of diseases, like, you know, just an example, schizophrenia, is about 80% heritable. And they do, you know, genome-wide association studies with 50,000 people, and they cannot explain more than a couple percent of the heritability. Where is it? It's got to be in there. And it's like they have to think, or somebody has to think differently about this and come up with something. And I think there must, you know, be someone out there. There is even a little bit of a tendency, I think, in the life sciences to do factory science. You know, it's difficult to be sort of the lone scientist who just sits back and really thinks and comes up with something and tries it out. It's so much about big groups and, you know, big machines and apparatuses and computers. And I don't think it's the next big breakthroughs won't come from there.
So you're sensing a bit of a dead end in the way that big life sciences are done right now.
In a way, yeah.
Great story of exploration.
There's a great story, I believe, of scientific discovery that's sort of the kernel of my information book, and that is and what's great about it, paradoxically, is that there isn't any particular thing that's discovered. And this is Claude Shannon's two-part journal articles published in 1948, Claude Shannon being an electrical engineer and mathematician at Bell Labs, called A Mathematical Theory of Communication. And there are a whole bunch of results put together, not any one of which would be worth my describing right now to this audience. Some of them I try to describe in the book. And yet I believe that this single moment in scientific history is a turning point, and it's a fulcrum on which our age is built. And that's an extended argument that I make in my book. And the question is, how did this happen? One thing I can say about it, to sum it up, is that it's a moment when information is first treated scientifically as a thing, as a quantity, as a thing to be measured. And the unit of measure that is invented for this purpose, we all know, is the bit. Yes or no, on or off. And these papers by Claude Shannon were the first time that any scientist used the word bit in this way, defined as a unit of measure for this thing called information. And before this moment, information was something fuzzy. It was an ancient word in all the dictionaries, but vague. And after this moment, information was something very specific and meaningful to scientists. And everything springs from that. And it is a kind of scientific discovery in the sense that you have to ask the question, why Claude Shannon? Why at this moment in history? What did he need to know? What were the building blocks of this theory? And they involve previous work in genetics. He tried to, when he was a graduate student, create a symbolic algebra for genetics, and in early analog computing, and all sorts of bits and pieces of things, many of them related in one way or another to the idea of coding, that all come together at a certain point in time. And that makes it possible to tell a story about science, about the process of doing science, that's the thing that excites me.
Well, physicists call it non-determinism. I suppose actors call it spontaneity. Writers call it suspense, a sense that something happens that is not fundamentally predicted. In your writing, there are people who've had that experience of feeling the breakthrough, and you've described it in some of your work as overwhelming, that it is a profoundly emotional experience, that you have to sit down for 2 hours because you realize that you've kind of busted through some fabric of reality and seen something ahead of everyone else. Is that part of the story of breakthroughs in physics?
You love to have those moments. They're rare in mere mortals' lifetimes, but someone like Einstein, who is sort of this great character around which many physics stories are built, had an experience that aligns directly with what you are describing. When he came up with the general theory of relativity, I say came up, it was a 10-year-long journey to figure out this new way of thinking about gravity, he applied it to a puzzle, which was the so-called precession of the perihelion of Mercury. Mercury's orbit was kind of turning in a way that Newtonian gravity would not suggest it should. So people had hypothesized maybe there's some hidden planet out there, Vulcan, that's pulling on it and thereby changing its orbit. But Einstein sat down with the general theory of relativity, calculated Mercury's orbit, and there he found the precession of the perihelion in the equations. And Einstein himself described it as, when he realized this, it gave him heart palpitations for days, because he had seen this deep truth that nobody else had seen before. This precession of the perihelion of Mercury, nobody cared about that, but it meant that general relativity was actually describing how gravity worked in a way that was far deeper than anything that Newton had given us. So, yes.
And while we're on that subject, we can't leave out Newton being hit on the head with the apple in the
right.
First place. I mean,
according to Einstein, Newton's head went up and hit the apple. It was the reverse, but that's another story.
And, you know, in the Marx Brothers movie, it's a whole bushel of apples that falls on his head. And yet, there is, I mean, I had to deal with this one way or another in my biography. I knew I was going to have to. I had to deal with it when they were designing the jacket. I had to talk them out of putting the apple on the cover. And no apple ever hit Newton in the head, by the way. And not only that, when you think about it, you know that Newton didn't need an apple falling to give him the insight that there is such a thing as gravity. Everybody knew that stuff falls down. I mean, so...
But he did chop John the cherry tree, right?
But another creation myth. But I firmly believe that there is something there. I mean, this apple story has its roots in almost don't do that, Brian. In almost contemporary accounts, and Newton obviously did discover something important about gravity. So if everybody knew that stuff fell down, what did he discover? Well, he did discover something that I believe we have almost lost the ability to comprehend, because we live in a world where we, whether or not we are physicists, understand quite a bit about gravity from so early in our lives that we don't know it. I mean, you hold your arm out and you can, don't you feel that there's a force pulling it down to Earth? I mean, you know that there's gravity all around us and it pulls things down. But Newton didn't know that. Nobody in Newton's time understood that. They only knew that things fell down, which is not the same as knowing that there is an invisible force that attracts objects one to another. The apple story also has something to do with the moon, and I do believe that, based on not absolutely convincing evidence, that Newton was sitting in his garden at the age of 22 or 23, home from Cambridge during the plague years, and looking at an apple in his orchard. I mean, you can go to his house and they'll point out the descendant of the tree. And noticing that it's essentially the same size as the moon, which would also have been visible. And we know that he was thinking about what kept the moon in orbit. And the real insight, the astounding insight, the thing that we can never thank Newton enough for, is that the same force that pulls an apple down to Earth is the force that's keeping the moon from flying away into infinity.
Do they also point out the place where the aliens landed in the orchard to tell him all of that? They don't. One of the great things about physics is that it is such a process of the imagination to try to think about something that you don't necessarily have tangible physical evidence of, gravity notwithstanding. Of course, you do have physical evidence of that. Does the science of medicine, which is all about cures and healing the sick, make it harder for us to understand life science in the pure way that we sometimes think about physics, because there's such a tendency to put life sciences into some sort of medical, curative, disease-curing context?
Yeah. I mean, I, as a biologist, think that, you know, medical science is... it's not always science in a way. I mean,
have to whisper that.
It's not really very interesting. I mean, to me at least, it would be nice if they could cure cancer, definitely, but it's not hugely interesting. What is interesting in the life sciences, I think, is, you know, to understand what on earth is life? How does it get so diverse? How do we, you know, understand ourselves? What is a self, by the way? There's probably, you know, as we are starting to see, there's probably not even a self in there. It's just a trick that our consciousness is playing on us. There is no self. It's not a soul. It's not a self.
Good trick, though.
But, but the medical thinking has sort of infected everything in a way that when we talk about, for example, I mean, look at psychiatry. Psychiatry is everywhere in society. We understand ourselves as, oh, I'm a little bit ADHD, or my kid is probably a little bit Asperger, or whatever it is. And all that is sort of, it's a thinking of, you know, you're either well or you're sick, in a way. And that's not nature at all. I mean, there's biological variation out there. There's not sick or well, or good or bad. Even when we talk about genes, you know, people are so afraid of good and bad genes. There are genes, and they vary, and some of them, you know, fit very well with one environment, some of them fit very well with another environment. And I think that if we could get rid of the very, very medical thinking about who we are, for example, it would be, you know, a lot more interesting to be human.
One of the things that I just want to say this, that I think is really great about Lona's book, is that it describes a type of science that at the moment is in a certain amount of disarray. It feels to me as though there's a lot of confusion. There are the most wonderful things going on, the ability to sequence genomes in that kind of detail, and the things that are being discovered about particular markers, all of which you point out. But there are also, there's a host of terms that feel ill-defined. People have to figure out whether there is a gene for schizophrenia. And then they have to figure out, well, what is schizophrenia? And is schizophrenia the thing that we have just said this is the gene for? And in that case, do we have a circular definition? And writing about that kind of science, which is not final and unsettled and yet undeniably important, is a particular challenge that I think your approach of framing the story through a personal journey was especially well suited to.
Yeah, I would come back to the fact that I simply dislike, you know, packaged stories. Like, you know, oh, there is a solution to this. No, to most of what they're searching for out there, there is no solution yet. And it's not very interesting to get these sort of pseudo solutions that a lot of people will offer. Oh, this is what creativity is. We don't really know. We know a little bit about creativity, but there are tons of books on, you know, this is creativity and this is how you, you know, increase creativity. And it's so much more interesting to look at, you know, how are they even discussing these things? How are they trying to figure out what these things are? Schizophrenia, creativity, the self, whatever it is. And how will it, you know, how could it play out if it's this and not this?
Well, there's a real hunger out there. I mean, forgive me for this. Do you know how high your books have ever gotten on Amazon, Lona?
No.
Ever gotten in the top 10?
Oh, no.
You probably have, right? Maybe once in a while. You probably have, maybe.
If I monitored that sort of thing, I would not admit
it. Do you know what the number five book on Amazon was last week?
No.
The number five? The DSM. The fifth version of the DSM, which when it came out in 1948 was 420 pages, probably weighed, you know, I could probably hold it. The DSM-5, and was read by almost nobody in 1948, probably. And the DSM-5, the fifth version of the DSM, is 1,000 pages. It's published both digitally and in a published form, and reached number five on the Amazon. And very expensive, and still. People buy it. I mean, there's a yearning for understanding and a grasping at what seems like clarity, which is what the DSM is. And if you read it, it does seem very frightening with its imprecision and having acronyms for all kinds of conditions that we might think of as just, I was sad on Thursday. but have you created a monster in the sense that people have this idea that they can understand and we'll grab at anything that offers certainty. And as interesting as ambiguity is to you, people don't want it.
But I sort of think that it's the human condition that we have to live with it, and we should get used to it, and we should learn to love it in a way. And I mean, for example, the DSM-5, that is such a good story, the whole DSM story of, you know, how psychiatry is really trying to be seen as a science. And it's probably at the stage where, you know, the rest of medicine, somatic medicine, was in the 1800s. And every good psychiatrist will tell you that. We have no idea why we can treat depression with SSRIs. No idea. It has nothing to do with serotonin. You know, we have no idea why the antipsychotics actually work, and so on and so forth. And then you have the DSM-5, which is kind of a Bible. And it's such a political document, you wouldn't believe it. I mean, like, they decided at some point way back in the 70s, now we, you know, we take out homosexuality. We don't call it a disease anymore, fine. Then you also had, at that time, PMS, premenstrual syndrome. That was also taken out as, you know, a disease, because women were up in arms, or, you know, this is just normal, it's not a disease, don't call, you know, women's things diseases, fine. Now it comes back, because now people want to be seen as having a real disease when they have PMS.
So. Oh, yes. Maybe a panel for next year's World Science Festival, eh? Okay. What evidence do the three of you have, who are all widely read, that your work has made people smarter about the subjects that you write about, James?
I get some nice email from time to time. But I don't like neatly tied up packages. My goal isn't for people to think, aha, here, you know, now I finally understand this, the end. If people finish my books and think things are sort of in a mess and they don't fully understand it, that's, I consider that desirable, as long as they also are aware that the scientists themselves are in the same state of incomplete knowledge. We have a tendency, I think maybe from the way we learn science in school, or I don't know where we get this idea, but I believe we have a tendency to think of science as handed down to us on stone tablets. You know, there's a set of tablets.
Where did that come from?
From Newton. Well, okay. Right. That's a metaphor, by the way.
Yeah.
And then there's a new set of tablets from Einstein, and there's some corrections in that one, and now the tablets have gotten, you know, very multimedia. But that's not the version of science that I'm interested in writing about. I'm interested in writing about the process, and the process involves mistakes, and it involves communication and sometimes faulty communication. And it involves personalities and antagonism and sometimes lonely discovery and other times exciting communal efforts. And when it's done, if you think, okay, here's a group of scientists who have achieved a perfect understanding of whatever the subject is, and I have achieved some version, some translated version of that understanding, well, that is not my goal. I want to tell a story about how we learn things, we as humans. And it's a story that I believe in, you know, as an outsider looking in. And I think it's an important story.
Do you believe you've contributed to scientific fluency in the physical sciences and physics?
You know, it's hard to say. I have not done any surveys, so I don't have any real data of that sort. But when I give talks at various places around the country, inevitably some college student comes up to me and says, I read your book when I was 10, and I'm like, really? That makes me so old. But, you know, he says, you know, and then he says, and that's why I do physics. So I don't know if it makes anyone any smarter or more fluent, but if it excites them to want to know more and to really pursue it, and then they can get smarter and know it better, then I feel like it was worth doing.
It's a brand, though. Brian Greene writes physics even a 10-year-old can understand. Not too many Columbia University professors would go there. But I think it's great that all of you have both embraced the importance of, the cultural importance of understanding and exploration in science, and also, I think on some level, a mission for improving the sense of understanding, because that makes for better citizens, I think, better understanding of some of the scientific questions that face all of us. What do you think people need to understand more about the life sciences, and what evidence do you have that your stories have helped them to do that?
What evidence? I get a lot of hate mail, but other than that, I think the best sort of reaction I ever got was I was giving a talk at a museum in Denmark, and there was this really old lady who came up to me with my book on neuroscience, and she said, you know, it's like, you know, I've read this and all this about how we're, you know, biological organisms, and it's like, you know, my life has started over. I'm questioning everything I've lived by. This is really interesting. I thought that was great. You know, if you can start over at 80 or whatever, because you read a book and you question everything, that is, yeah.
What science do you not understand, and what books have you read that have helped you to understand something that you don't fundamentally understand outside of your discipline?
I read very, very little nonfiction, to be honest.
Really?
Yeah.
What fiction has helped you understand something?
I think the greatest book I've read about science, and I so wished I could have written that, was Measuring the World by Daniel Kehlmann, German author, philosopher and author. Great book.
Reading recommendation from you, Jim?
Reading recommendations?
Yeah.
Well, you know, seriously, both
safe
of them. There's a lot of science. There's hardly any science that I do understand. But because I'm in the business that I'm in, I don't go to books generally for the understanding. I'm able to talk to people and ask stupid questions and get them to educate me. And that's part of, well, that's part of the process for me, not receiving the information in translated form in books.
Primary sources.
So don't buy our books, I think is the message.
How about you, Brian?
You know, like Lana, I don't actually read a whole lot. I wouldn't even say nonfiction. It's sort of across the board these days in terms of book form. But in terms of an early science book that certainly had an impact on me, it would be The Selfish Gene. Because it was in an area that I knew very little about and still know very little about, but it was written in such a poetic way where the journey, the story was so captivating that it was so different from anything I'd really read that had anything to do with science before.
Author, for those who are...
Richard Dawkins. So it really did give a sense of science can be presented in a different way.
Do you think the whole is there a God, is there not a God discussion that Dawkins helped to instigate along with Christopher Hitchens and some others helped understanding, was a legitimate sort of scientific kind of foray into the civic discourse?
No, I don't. I mean, I feel strongly about that. I feel like they spoke to the people that already had the opinion that they held and made everybody else angry. I don't imagine how anybody could be convinced to give up a belief by being told that they're stupid. And moreover, I think that the notion that science can somehow come down from on high and declare that ideas that people have held for thousands of years were absolutely wrong feels religious to me too. So, no.
Boy, that is the last, I did not expect that answer. That's great. That, and that's a spontaneous
moment.
I should say,
because we did an event with Richard. Boy, I think he's great. I love him. He's fantastic. But we did an event recently in Arizona, and I was pleased to see that the tone, at least by my reading, and maybe the version of his public description of these ideas was limited and not representative, but it had shifted. And it was much more, he was saying, I only want people to start to question things and think about things. And that is fine. I think that's great. You do want to poke people so that ideas that they're holding and not questioning, they may think about, that's a good thing. And I think that approach does work. It feels different for me than some of the earlier versions that I heard.
I think that's really the point. And a kind of difficult thing for those of us who write about science is that on the one hand, we believe in science. We believe that science is the path to knowledge you can trust. And on the other hand, what we treasure in science is a kind of humility, that we do not want to treat our scientists as priests. If we want priests, we can go to religion for that. Scientists are supposed to be people who are always unsure, even of their most beloved results, who are always willing to be skeptical about their own work, and who are not looking for absolute truth, but for an ongoing process.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, what it's about, it's not science or scientists, it's the scientific method seems to me to be the best thing that we have. It's questioning, questioning, questioning. I think it's really interesting living in Europe and living in Northern Europe and in Scandinavia, which is, you know, Denmark has been called by Phil Zuckerman nation without God, which it probably is. It's a discussion that over there never really took off. And like militant atheism, it's like, what? Why would you be militant about atheism? Isn't that the default path? Like, and so it's very much a cultural thing. And I mean, I can see that people like Dawkins and Harris and Hitchens must have put a lot of people off. And from where I sat, you know, over there, it was just so funny to see, how can people get so riled up over this, you know?
Well, you had your difficulties in Europe with the Catholic Church a few centuries ago, so you kind of got over it.
Yeah.
Pretty violent way, but...
Well, you have to clean out
house
sometimes.
Yeah, right, just house cleaning, yes. Yeah. That's what we call it. Finally, you know, I wasn't going to bring this up, but since, you know, there are such treasures in science, both in terms of the characters, the discoveries, the insights, Are you familiar, you know Paul Dirac, the physicist, right? Are you familiar with this book that was written about him over the last 2 years?
I know, The
Strangest Man in the World.
Farmello?
Yeah,
I have not read it.
It's a book I would recommend, and it really talks about a physicist who is not a hero, someone who had real difficulty communicating, who was a very strange character, but who brought unbelievable insights and was part of the team that helps us to understand the physics of today. It's a book that would probably never get published. It was a passion of a science writer who wanted to bring his story out. It's a fantastic read. And if you are familiar with some of the other scientists that you've talked about in your books and that you've talked about in your books, and even you, I think you really get a sense that there's an endless diversity of characters in this field of science who bring insights in their own way. And the idea of the light bulb going off, the expected sort of classical happy ending insight, is not how science is done, and it's still a fantastic story. I want to thank all of you for joining us today. This has been really terrific and fascinating and wonderful.
Thank you.